Hello everyone, it's Silvia from Tarot. Welcome to my channel. Today we're going to have a look at a couple of decks that just entered my collection. We're going to have a look at the first impressions and we're also going to try a couple of pairings, you never know. So this is the first one and well, I can see through the wrapping paper what it is. It's the Wild Child Oracle. This is from the recent Kickstarter. And to be honest with you, I haven't seen it much around yet. And the reason why I'm excited about this one is because this one has a very, let's say it's the same Wild Child Oracle that you know, that you probably know, but it's got a standard tarot shape as opposed to the really odd one that it used to come with. So the one with the rounded edges on top and bottom. That deck was amazing, don't get me wrong. I think that it was really beautiful and it was slightly larger, I believe. And I'm not entirely sure that this one will have, let's say enough room or enough space on the surface of the cards to show all of the artwork that the other one did. Because obviously you have a bit of a loss when you adapt to a different shape. You cut off from the top and the bottom, which is not entirely a problem, you know, depending on what you end up cutting off. But it's very much what I was looking forward to because I could not use the other one because of its shape. And I really wanted to because I really believe that it's a very beautiful deck. And okay, if you're not familiar with this, it's by the same creator and illustrator as the Healing Waves Tarot. So they also produced and illustrated this Oracle deck. As I said, the initial one came out with rounded tops and bottoms. And it came out a couple of years ago, I think, just immediately after the Healing Waves Tarot. And then after that, they also, I think they also launched or created the Wild Child Tarot, which I have seen in a few channels. However, I had a possibility to buy that one, you know, on the Kickstarter campaign as well, but I didn't because I feel that it was very similar to the Healing Waves, and the Healing Waves has a very specific, let's say, affectionate meaning for me. So it's something that I did not want to replace, and I didn't even want to look for something that would eventually replace that. But I really did want to get my hands on this Oracle deck because I'm looking forward to pair it up with the Healing Waves Tarot. Now, generally speaking, I don't really like to cheat. So between brackets, cheating when we're looking at a Tarot and Oracle deck pairings is when, you know, you kind of know that it's going to pair up really well because it's the same illustrator. So that, I call it, you know, in a funny way, I call it cheating. It's not really cheating, you can do whatever you want, obviously. But in this case, I think that it feels like it can really work out. I'm just curious about, you know, how it looks like. So we're just going to have a look at the deck first, the Wild Child Oracle. I have to say, this two-part box is a bit too tight. I'm actually really struggling to open it, which means that either it's because there's been a little bit of humidity that probably penetrated the cardboard of the box that made it expand, or the measurements were not 100% accurate. Either way, I may have to find a bag for this deck because it's a bit too tight. Like if I have to struggle every time to open it, I know myself and it's just going to drive me away from using it. So it comes with a guidebook. Now, I'm not sure you can read this. I can't either. And I'm also wearing my glasses, but these are supposed to be the names of the creators and the illustrator. I recognize this one, Junasiri, as the illustrator. I cannot read this name. I wish they used a different color to write it other than white, because it's not necessarily easy to tell what it says there. And the writing is very small as well, but it's okay. So this deck is really, really beautiful. I've seen it plenty of time, and I'm sure you have too. On the previous version, you know, where the buttons were rounded. I'm also really curious about the cardstock, because I don't know if you're aware, but the English version of the Healing Waves was printed in a very gluey sort of rose petal cardstock. And back then, a few years ago, maybe 3 years ago when it was printed, that was something that they hadn't really, let's say, evolved into the newer kind of rose petal cardstock, which is actually exceptional. And as a matter of fact, it reminds me a lot of the newer Blue Angel cardstock. That's absolutely fantastic. It feels really silky to the touch. So the tactile experience is really positive, really beautiful, but the cards don't stick to each other. That's the latest. I think it's a bit of an evolution on the on that matter. We see here that we've got only a couple of sentences for each and every card, and the card time, the booklet is in black and white, which is fine. We don't really need colors because we have the cards, so that's great. We do have a couple of sentences, and to be honest with you, there are a few cards in this deck that probably will need me to go back to the guidebook every now and then, probably because they're not necessarily as straightforward as a keyword as you might think. Or, you know, okay, we have a spider as well. It really depends on, you know, what the deck is, if it's resonating with me, if the images and the, together with the card, with the keyword, they're resonating or not. Now, the cardstock is fantastic. I really looked forward to this. It's a matte cardstock. It's a very, it's almost a papery kind of cardstock, but it's very sturdy. You can tell it's really high quality, very easy to fan out, and it's got nothing to do with that, you know, that what I was saying before, that peachy, it's like the surface of a peach, so the rose petal that we call it, how we call it in English. I think that, yeah, it's one of those decks that if you just use the cards like that and create some friction one against the other, you can hear that kind of really nice sound. It reminds me a lot of the Ember and Aura, for example, cardstock. Nice size. It looks like a standard tarot size. And again, it's the numbers are a bit big, but it was the same as the other deck, so I've got nothing against it. It's absolutely fine. Just as long as it's clear, you know, and the keyword is clear as well. I would be very interesting to see a comparison. I don't have the other deck, but it would be very, very interesting to see, for example, in this case, where we see that the character that is illustrated on the front of the card has got their head cut off a little bit at the top. So I will be obviously curious to see whether in the other format with the rounded edges on top and bottom, this head will be complete. I don't think that it's necessary, and I'm not bothered at all by that. It's just a curiosity of mine, you know, to see what the difference with the two would be like. If you have this deck, I mean the original one, let me know, because I don't have it with me, and I just seem to recall that there may have been a border, like a really tiny border, a white one. I could be completely wrong though, there's so many decks around these days, it's difficult to just remember details about every one of them. But it feels like a really silky, papery cardstock that has got a fantastic experience. It really gives you a nice feedback. And as you can tell, the art style is very recognizable. If you have the Healing Waves tarot, you will see, you know, the watercolor style of the illustrator, Junasiri, which is one of my favorite, by the way. The Healing Waves tarot is by far one of my most cherished decks. I rarely use it. I do sometimes use it to do a reading, but I rarely do. And that's probably one of the reasons why the silky cardstock is still pretty much gluey, because I don't use it that much. But I do hear people say that after you use it for a while, it loses that kind of gluey, feel to it. This card is so beautiful. The reflection, I love the fact that the reflection shows a different kind of color on the plumage of the swan, I think it is. So I'm so very happy that I've got this. As I said, it was a recent Kickstarter campaign. It just arrived today at my place. I think it's, you know, going to be distributed around the world. To come from Thailand didn't take that long to Australia, and here we got the spider. Well, you see, at least this is the typical garden spider, so I've got nothing against it. It's fine. This is, you know, you have a garden, you have spiders. There's no two ways around that, right? Yeah, I get it. It's the big ones. It's the big ones that I'm not too comfortable with. So what I'm going to do, I've got another couple of decks. What we're going to do is we're going to go through the other two decks, and then we're picking this back up, and I'm going to try and pair it up with a couple of tarot decks. All right, so what have we got here? This is obviously coming from Amazon, from the US, because it was one of the tarot decks that I got during the Black Friday sale. And I have to say, this was a little bit of a lost tarot, in the sense that I personally had lost all my hope to ever get it. It came to Australia, then it was delayed at customs. I guess sometimes they in at customs in Sydney, they're just really odd, and they just do random checks, as you would expect any kind of customs would do, probably. I mean, I have no idea, but that's how I suppose they do that. And this one was caught in the bureaucracy of it all, and they wanted more information. So I got contacted by Amazon US saying that they needed more information, and I was like, you're the guy sending it to me. What more information can I provide to them, you know, that you cannot? So that went nowhere. And then it was really weird, because obviously they have algorithms looking at this kind of stuff, and when the delivery day came and went, it obviously, it sent a feedback that the deck had not been delivered yet, and so they kind of sent me a message saying that it hadn't even shipped yet. But that was obviously a mistake, because I knew for a fact that it was in Sydney, that it had arrived in Sydney, it was just stuck at customs. And so I started Googling and thinking, okay, what if I eventually call customs and ask them what do they need, and what kind of documents I can provide them in order to be able for them to clear it. And I got nowhere, because no one knew what I was talking about. And then after that, what happened? Something else happened. I don't remember. It went. So it looked like it was moving. So it came closer to me, to the place where I live. And I thought, oh, it's going to be out for delivery soon. That's good. And instead, then it went back to Mascot. And if you live in Australia or in Sydney, you will know Mascot is the place where it's very close to the airport, and it's basically where they clear customs. So I thought, okay, so it's going back to customs now, or is it going back to the US? And I looked into Amazon again, and there was a message saying your cancel request has been accepted. I'm like, I certainly didn't ask to cancel the order, and I just don't know what happened there. I had given up on it. And then all of a sudden, I placed another order on Amazon, Australia this time, not thinking too much about it, because I needed some stuff. And then it just got delivered together with the rest of the order. And I was like, well, okay, I'm not saying no. I mean, I'm quite happy that I finally received it. So it was the deck that was lost, and now it's found, and I'm quite happy to have it here. I have to say, like, I've heard so many people saying they were hesitant about this deck when they considered whether to get it or not. I too was very hesitant about it. I am not too bothered by one of the main things that seemed to emerge in the hesitancy about getting this deck is that all of the characters in the cards are rather young. To be honest with you, I got over that when I started using the Cosmic Cycle again, because I just realized that it's the symbology behind the card that counts, at least to me, and I'm not necessarily bothered by the fact that I don't recognize with any of the characters in here. There's not much age diversity, but it is fine because I may look at the images and recognize maybe memories or something that in any case can resonate with me. There is just one small problem with this deck and the reason why I was hesitant about getting it, but then when I saw the price on Amazon Black Friday sale, I was all for it because it was so cheap. Ironically, I was quite happy because I saw it at a local bookstore and it was $30 more expensive, so I was really happy that I got it for such a really good price. Now, there is, and I'm just gonna be 1000% honest with this, and I'm going to explain why I was hesitant, and the reason is this card here. So, I had a horrible time during the pandemic. It was really horrible for me for many, many reasons. One of them is I lost my dad and I was not allowed to go to his funeral. So there's a number of things that really amounted to a trauma, a trauma society that came together and I looked kindly at everyone. Unfortunately, that was not the case. But then again, I don't think it was the case anywhere. I mean, the signs that I've seen in London, in the London Metro, they could have been there for a reason because maybe there were a lot of attacks. People not wearing a mask had been attacked. So that's why they had to put on the sign. I have no idea, but this is my story and this is the reason why I was hesitating in getting this deck. And I simply, I would have loved to have a different experience. And perhaps, one day we'll look back and we'll think that we could do a lot of things in a different way. Even though I'm not even sure that these things help you in any case, after everything that has happened. We just hope that it doesn't happen again, that's all. So I'm looking at this deck and I really like the colors. I like the body diversity, the skin tone diversity. I love also the sentences or the messages, let's say, at the bottom of the cards where you see the title of the card. The Queen of Cups, for example, says, "Honoring your emotions is one of the highest forms of self-care." So that's really nice. And it's a deck that I'm really happy that it finally came to my doorstep. Safe Haven, Five of Pentacles. Oh, that's nice. Nothing is ever as hopeless as it seems. That's wonderful. That's really wonderful. So I'm really looking forward to use this deck because of the messages, because of the images. I love this one. Look at that, the Ten of Pentacles. It's just having it all looks different to everyone. Absolutely. Oh, I couldn't agree more. Look at the kitten. That's so cute. The witch is in. Queen of Pentacles. Thanks for supporting local witches. It is a beautiful deck. There's no two ways around that. It's, it's okay to cry. The Three of Swords. I love the way it's been done. I think that it's a very spot on. It will be a very spot on reader. That's what I'm thinking and I'm hoping so. Because I'm always for a deck that gives it a possibility to look at the cards in a different way and perhaps adopt a different perspective on what the meaning of the cards are. I mean, after all, there's only so many times in which you can rehearse the way you memorize the 78 cards. It's what a new deck that gives you that is different from other decks and that you can think about it, and then you can, you know, determine whether you accept a new meaning or not. Let me just understand this card, because I saw, okay, she's covered in band-aids. It would take a hell of a lot more to defeat you. Okay, gotcha. These are Nine of Wands. Okay. Yes, that's nice. I'm really, really excited about using this deck. And yeah, so that's the second one that came to me this week. Let's have a look. There's another one. Okay, so what have we got here? Oh yeah, of course, I completely forgot about this deck as well, the Goddess of Love Tarot. I kid you not, I think this one was only $15 Australian on Amazon for the Black Friday sale. And I thought to myself, you know, I might as well get it, because I have heard a lot about this deck, and I've heard most of the reviews I've read about it were positive. So if it doesn't resonate, I may as well, you know, rehome it. It's not something that bothers me too much. But I was looking for a, not specifically a Goddess of Love tarot, but a Goddess tarot. I don't know whether this Goddess of Love, a book and deck for home, embodying the erotic divine feminine. I'm not entirely sure that, you know, I will vibe with this one, but for that price, I really wanted to try it out, as a matter of fact. I mean, it comes with a really nice two-part box, and it looks like it's got a nice guidebook as well. Let's have a look. So there's no thumbprint, but we don't really need it because we got the cards. And it's got two pages, at least two pages that I can see. Yes, two pages dedicated to the card. At least when it comes to the major arcana. I don't know whether they are going to stick to that, to the minors. No, they don't. It's only one page when it comes to the minors, but it's fine. So we've got the astrological correspondence as well, which is very interesting. I wonder if it's they're all correct. Because I know that it sounds a bit odd, but I can assure you 100% that in many, many cases, there's decks that don't keep the astrological correspondence, or at least the, let's say, agreed upon astrological correspondence. But this one does, because I see the 5, 6, and 7 of swords. We got the Venus, Mercury, and Moon in Aquarius. Thank you so much. I'm an Aquarius. Every time that I see this, I'm like, yay. And why not? But it's, yeah, there you go. The Queen of Swords is the water of air. That's why the Queen of Swords is not just air, it's the water of air. So it's, I don't know. I mean, I am open-minded, 100%. There's a couple of spreads here, isn't it? Let me see. A Goddess of Love Blessing, Tarot Spreads, Card of the Day, 3-card spreads. For life, death, and rebirth, clarity, mind, body, and spirit, a message from the goddess, explore sex magic, a spread to heal heartbreak, oh, a spread to meet the goddess of love and lust. So it's obviously very corporeal. There is a lot of power given back to the body. So I'm expecting a certain kind of imagery. There might be, I haven't seen any walkthrough or flip-throughs of this deck. I've seen a couple of images on Instagram, but there might be some nudity, so I'm just gonna warn you. I also know that not everyone is super happy about the borders with this deck, so I wonder if anyone has this deck. Have you tried trimming off the borders, because that might actually work. So the cardstock, not well, it's okay. It's, I mean, I repeat, $15. What am I expecting? It's not a terribly great kind of cardstock. I mean, we went from the Wild Child Oracle to the Cozy Witch tarot deck, which is, by the way, it's got a really nice cardstock. With this one, it's not the best. It feels like you can almost tear it apart, but that's fine. I mean, it's one of those decks that you're meant to use. You're meant to use it, obviously. You're meant to read with it. So, as a matter of fact, you know, it's not one of those decks that is precious at all. Yes, I had this idea that it was a collage, photographic collage, and it definitely is so. I have to say, it looks to me like it could be a manual collage, but maybe not. It is difficult nowadays to understand whether a collage, unless the creator specifically, you know, explains what they've done, it's not very easy to identify whether a deck has been handmade, a collage deck has been handmade or digitally created. So these are the major arcanas. Oh, I like that the Justice card is called Balance, or is it? So let's have a look at okay, so I was saying the card number 8, I just wanted to check. So card number 8 and card number 11. Card number 8 has been renamed. It is the Strength card, but it has been renamed Last. And I'm just going to read out of the guidebook. So basically, the heart is the most enlightened technology available to lead you in a life aligned with love and rooted in strength. Through the goddess, the strength of heart becomes lust. Lust isn't a sin. Lust is a driving desire. It is the push and pull for connection, for intimacy, for union. Okay, I like this interpretation because in some cases we lose sight when we rename the major or the minors or the court cards, etc. We may lose sight of the original or the main meaning of the card. But when we see lust as the vital energy, the vital strength to push for life, I absolutely am on board with that. I actually really like it. And I also like the Justice card to be renamed Balance, because to me, Justice, when the difference, every one of my students has always asked me the difference between the Justice card and the Judgment card. And I refer back to Rachel Pollack. So basically, she says that the Justice card, they are consequences for you as an individual. So you are, as an individual, you are asked to answer of the consequences of your act. And that is the re-establishment of a certain equilibrium, a certain balance, as we see here. Whereas the Judgment card is more like the end of all the possibilities. You're not being asked to rectify of anything you've done anymore. And it's not the re-establishment of a balance, it's the end of the balance. So it's a justice that shows the consequences in the Judgment card of your actions as you, as an individual in the society. So when it comes to the Justice card, it's just the consequences for yourself. And when it comes to the Judgment card, it's the consequences as related to your position and your role in society. I like the word balance for the Justice card. And I really like this Death card. So it reminds me of Kali Ma, but obviously we only have a couple of arms here. So there's a few arms missing there, although it does show a lot of skulls. This one would probably pair up really well with the Tantri Dakini Oracle, which I actually don't have anymore because I rehomed it. I probably shouldn't have. It's just it's one of those, you know, have one of those things when a deck doesn't resonate and it still doesn't, and I just don't really find a space, a very specific space for that deck in my collection, then, you know, someone else will appreciate it more than me, and that's my reason for rehoming decks. This is the Star card. I always pay attention to the Star cards because even if it's true that in the minors the cards related to Aquarius are the 5, 6, and 7 of Swords, which are not, let's face it, the best cards in the deck, when it comes to the major arcanas, the card that is embodied by the sign of Aquarius is the Star card, which is my favorite. And also, I believe, if not the most positive card in the majors, probably one of the most positive ones. To me, it's the card of hope and healing from the ancestors and you know, and also the card of guidance. You see the light that is guiding you through the darkness. It's absolutely fantastic. The moon, of course, with the scarab. And the sun, we're reminded of Ra. Judgment. And the world. And now, I don't know whether it's peepish or not, I have no idea. As I said, I haven't seen it much. So the two wands. Okay, so instead of wands, we have roses, obviously. Three of wands. There is some symbology that we can still find other than the pips representing the card. I'm guessing there is a lot of symbologies related to the animals appearing in the collage as well. And I do see the symbol for fire here as well in the fiery suit of wands, obviously. Not all of the cards have a very straightforward, let's say, reminder of what the meanings are. For example, this one doesn't necessarily... Let's see, just for the sake of, you know, finding that out. So the Nine of Wands, let's have a look at the Nine of Wands. So the Nine of Wands to me is the card of resilience. You're bruised and battered, but you're still going on because you realize that there's still something to be done, let's say. So it says here... I just want to see the card though, so let's put it there. Moon in Sagittarius, fine. Sometimes being inflamed with desire can cause your vision to become distorted. Okay. Consider separating yourself from your situation because you are too fired up and in your head, you're too fired up and in your head to see clearly. In any sort of relationship, whether with a partner or with the goddess herself, perspective is required. It can be incredibly difficult to get out of a rut. But if you choose to engage with your true will in a fresh way to break all patterns and trust in your heart, you can unlock new vantage points. Allow your lust to guide you, but don't hold on to the outcome too tightly. When this card presents itself reversed, know that there is another way and you've already begun to choose it. You're releasing your grasp on old ways of being and related to intimacy, no matter what kind, and rewriting the script. I am abundant with experiences and expressions of love, lust, and magic. There's also a journal question, how can I step into a new vantage point to see all the love and support in my life? It's a really beautiful meaning. I really love the message behind it, and I can definitely see the nine roses, so it is a nine of wands because it's got nine roses. However, I don't necessarily see the traditional meaning of the Nine of Wands in this deck. And in this card, not the whole deck. I'm just wondering if we got a bit of an influence from Thoth, for example, which could have explained a few cards, although not all of them. So I don't know. I think it might be a bit of a hybrid, or more simply, because for all kinds of reasons, the simplest explanation is probably the true one. The creator is just doing their own thing. And then we've got the court cards have been renamed the Maiden for the page, the Witch for the knight, and which will be probably easier to identify because there is this transportation, so you can tell that it's a knight because it's riding a jaguar, is it? Or I don't know what animal that is. The Queen of Wands, okay, we get it. And then the Crown of Wands as opposed to the King of Wands, which is fine. I do see the crown energy in the king anyway. So the Ace of Cups, the Two of Cups, the Three of Cups. I really want to find another card that I want to read about. For example, this one, why do we have... I mean, I know that it's the loss. It's probably identified as a heartbreak, so it's probably okay. The Six of Cups, the Seven of Cups, I can see the choices here as well. The Eight of Cups, she's giving, you know, she's turning her back on us, so she's leaving. The Nine of Cups is the wish come true, I can see that. The Ten of Cups and the Court cards. Let's just have a look at the swords. Okay, so we've got obviously the Ace of Swords, we got the Two of Swords. This is, I think I know the the correspondence in the in the card, in the character depicted in the card. So the Two Swords is often cast in a negative light, a shadow hanging on the liminal that comes between death and birth. Yet this card simply speaks of a need for stillness and inner knowing before making a decision. Slowing down and going inward isn't supported by our work culture or by Western society, even though pagans, witches and indigenous people have. Moments of integration and rest are critical for growth. The Two of Swords shows the gestation period. You are being asked to decide, and the thing is, no one can make this decision for you. Yeah, it's absolutely fine. I completely agree with this. I would love for them to explain to me what this character is, because I know that it's from the Egyptian mythology. And obviously it's a mother breastfeeding their son and or their child. But I also know that there's a lot of symbology here, and I'm just wondering whether, you know, there is a combination of meanings between the Two of Swords and indeed what it says here, which is very much what the RWS symbology is about when it comes to the Two of Swords and the character. But there doesn't seem to be any reference to the mythological figure. That's a pity, because honestly, I would have loved to complement my knowledge on that. I mean, learning something is always very interesting. And I can see the cocoon. So the Four of Swords, absolutely the cocoon, time to rest. The Five of Swords, so hang on a second, because this is the Three of Swords. And it's not a heart, it's a rose that has an eye, crying eye, in the middle. And there are three swords piercing the rose. So it's very traditional, except that instead of the heart, we have a rose. And then for the Five of Swords, we've got a pierced heart. Let's just see what it says for the Five of Swords. I don't want to read everything, but I'm still trying to understand. So Venus in Aquarius says, thank you. Remember when I said the swords are spicy and can sting, to say the least? Well, babe, that's where you are. The swords are intense, even in a normal reading, and when viewed through the guise of love and sex, it's especially true, because nothing feels quite so sensitive as matters of the heart. Okay, the Five of Swords mixes the mushroom power of the Fives with the pierce of the swords, provoking heartache, pain, or experiences that are less than ideal. You're left picking up the pieces and wondering what the fuck just happened. Sorry about that, didn't mean to say that, it was just written there. The Five of Swords reflects loss, and when the heart is hanging in the balance, it can feel like ego or death. Okay. Your suffering is real, but remember that this was the battle, not the war. This isn't the end, but more information you can use to move forward, more aligned and with more clarity. I honestly, where does it say it's reversed? It represents the release of pain and heartache. Okay, guiding you deeper into love. You have learned from the intensity and now you get to move through it. I'm just going to decide not to, you know, get a headache, that this deck is just doing its own thing and it's fine. I'm absolutely fine with that. It's, again, I will have to go back to the guidebook, probably for all of the cards, at least all of the minors, which is absolutely fine for me. It's just that I can feel already myself twitching and thinking that this is not, that was not the Five of Swords, and which is, again, it's fine. It's absolutely fine to have a different meaning to the card. So I need to just adjust myself, and that's all there is to it. And it's nice because it promotes flexibility, which I'm all for it. Eight of Pentacles. Now I'm expecting some cards to be more traditional and other not too. Like, for example, we see the Nine of Pentacles and the Ten of Pentacles. Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. I need to start using it clearly. I need to start reading with it, and I need to see whether it resonates with me or not. I don't know that it will, because sometimes I'm a bit, it's not that I'm not flexible, it's just that in order for a tarot deck to be doing their own thing, I kind of need a very, let's say, supported kind of system that shows that it has been reasoned, it has been researched, and it has a very valid reason to you know, get away from the mainstream. And I'm all for, again, I've got nothing against, as a matter of fact, I've actually been falling in love with a lot of decks that were going away, you know, taking a step away from the traditional symbology and meaning of the cards. But that was because they had a solid, a super solid base. For example, the Mariel Tarot is, in many, many cards, they don't correspond to the traditional symbology and meaning, but it is so powerful that I don't mind that, and it felt like going to school and learning something new. And I'm completely open to learn something new when it comes to this deck as well. So I'm not saying anything for now. I really need to start working with it. Okay, so the first deck I'm gonna pair the Wild Child Oracle with is a bit of an obvious choice. As I was saying before, it's the same creator, illustrator, so Nawan Junasiri. And I'm going to pair it with the Healing Waves Tarot. This is the original Indiegogo, sorry, it wasn't a Kickstarter, it was actually an Indiegogo production release. So I am very excited about this. I've been waiting for this for a while because I really wanted to buy the other version of the Wild Child Oracle just for the purpose of pairing it up with the Healing Waves. The Healing Waves is such an amazing kind tarot deck for me that I really use it in very special occasions. But let's have a look at how they work together. Obviously you can recognize the style, and I'm not bothered at all, as I was saying before, by the big Roman numbers at the bottom of the cards on the Oracle, because in the economy of, you know, in the real estate of the card, they're not that prominent anyway. And as a matter of fact, there are big titles on the tarot cards as well. Now, I have to say, this looks like it's a match made in heaven. I know that it's kind of a given because, again, hello, same illustrator, same art style, practically same color palette. And also because now we also have a very similar kind of borders. As you can see here, the thin white line is very similar to both the decks. They have the same size as well. The only thing that is slightly different, as I was saying before, is the cardstock. This one is better. That's my opinion, but... And I know that if I were diligently using the tarot deck, I would probably get to the point in which the cards don't stick to each other anymore, which is absolutely fine, I don't mind. I will eventually get a copy of the French edition, which is supposed to be in between these two cardstock. It's not exactly like the cardstock of the Wild Child Oracle. However, I did hear that it wasn't rose petal, so I'm kind of curious now. I know that it sells for like $300 Australian. I've seen it the other day on Etsy. There was just one copy available. It was about $280 before shipping and GST. So yeah, I mean, it's something to consider perhaps for Christmas, but not even then, I don't know. We'll see. I think these two actually paired up really well. I mean, again, you know, with the proviso that I kind of expected them to pair up really well because it is the same art style. But I've never actually seen anyone pairing them up together. Maybe there were a couple of videos of someone who has received a Wild Child Oracle pairing it up with a Healing Waves, but it's not that popular. And as a matter of fact, I know that the Healing Waves Tarot, you don't really see it. I imagine the ones that do have it, they keep it safe, in a safe spot, because they don't want to ruin it, because now it sells for like $400. And the ones that, obviously, if you don't have it, you can't show it. But I really, really love these two together. And as I was saying, I was trying to understand whether the keywords would have been easy for me to, let's say, to resonate. And I can say that I don't seem to have any major problem with, you know, finding them talking to me. Gentleness between the Ten of Earth and the Queen of Earth. That gentleness, that nourishment that really does distinguish the Queen of Pentacles, the Queen of Earth. This is reaching a level of that kind of mastering of the queen's skills when it comes to reconnecting with nature that is expressed practically by both cards, the Ten of Earth and the Queen of Earth as well. And it is indeed characterized by gentleness and, you know, the kindness and the nourishing. Or, for example, we've got the fog, so perhaps the uncertainty between the Eight of Earth and the Two of Fire. So, of course, we are in a stage in our lives in which the Two of Fire tells us that whatever it is in front of us, our world is not big enough anymore for us, and we need to grow out of it, and we need to start looking into setting our wheels in motion and everything. But it's not necessarily clear, not everything is clear, so we need to really be sure and certain of what we want to do. We need to work hard. That is, you know, represented as a concept by the Eight of Earth. Or decay, for example, between the Queen of Air and the Eight of Fire. That is one of the things that we need to be aware of when there is the impersonification of the Queen of Air. It is true that the Queen of Air is the herald of truth, and she doesn't take any BS, and, you know, everything is either black and white, but that is a bit of a risk. So let's not be too harsh, because if we put our air with fire, the fire would actually grow even bigger. So perhaps let's not be hasty, because that is one of the risks. The decay is one of the risks of the Queen of Air. If you don't bring in water, there will be decay. I think it's really working. I think I like the way these two talk together. They have this kind of a conversation, and I'm really liking it. Besides, it's almost, you know, in many cases you will have the same animals, or you will have a bit of a let's say nod to nature. In many cases, I like the fact that we've got these round shapes that remind you know, that the create resonances. So that's a very nice pair. I really, really like how these two go together. Let's have a look at a couple of different decks that I think may go well with the Wild Child Oracle as well. So the second deck I want to try and pair with this is Star Child Tarot. This is the Akashic version by Danielle Noel. And I think that these two may go well together because of a certain ethereal vibe that I think I picked up on the Oracle deck while I was looking through it. Now, we don't expect a perfect match, because this is not the same artist, obviously, and it's not even the same kind of art style, and probably we're not even close when it comes to you know, the color palette, even though I'm starting to see some similarities in different cards. But it's the vibes that I want to pay attention to. So do they share the same vibe? Is it something that may work together when I use these two this way? So it's obviously something that you need to try it out. You cannot be certain 100% that something is working or not unless you try. So we've got Bloom with the Seven of Cups and the Four of Crystals. We definitely have that idea with the crystal. The Suit of Crystals is about nourishing, is the Suit of the Earth. So it's about that getting back in touch with nature, letting the light shine through in order to bring up also the different colors of the rainbow that reflect on the crystals, for example. So that there's obviously that full diversity of nature that is encompassed by the Suit of the Earth and in entirety, but also by the Four in its numerological sense of that consolidation that we achieve once we go after the growth of the Three. So we've got Bloom and the Four of Crystals. That is a very good combination. And the Seven of Cups can show us that in some cases we just really need to, when we are undecided, when we feel insecure, we feel that we don't really have a safe way to make a choice, like the Seven of Cups will suggest, perhaps going back to nature and resting on nature or consolidating on our skills to be grounded can possibly be helping us taking a decision. And let's see. Ember, that's the constant passing of time. But that Ember to me, it's such a beautiful thing. I used to have a thing for Ember. I used to have a lot of jewelry with Ember. And I remember, you know, whenever I was traveling, I was going to, for example, I went to Morocco and I really wanted to buy some Ember with an encased insect in them. But I found out that they're so expensive. I mean, the real ones, not the fake ones, the real ones are so expensive. And so I just couldn't afford it. It's either traveling or buying stuff when I'm traveling. So I always just traveling. What I like about the possibility that this oracle deck gives me when showing me the card for Ember is reminding myself of what the concept is here. The concept is that there is something that is fixed in time, and there is something that has withstood all the eras that have been characterizing the passing of time on the earth. So everything that has been, you know, gone through the cycle of decay and rebirth, the Ember is standing still, and it's also, you know, showing us the continuity throughout the passing of time. So I love that it's together with the Six of Cups, because it kind of gives me the idea that I need to look at the Six of Cups as that card, that yes, it is the kind of finding refuge in a kinder and simpler and easier time in the past. But that, if we look into it with the perspective card, which is the hanged one, tells us that perhaps that's the right thing to do at right now. Because the one thing that is a constant, that really goes through, and it's one constant through the passing of time, is that kind of comfort that is, it's almost as if it was this memory of this person is encased in Ember, because it's right there and it's not changing. Really, really love this combination. I didn't know that it was gonna be like this, but to be honest with you, I didn't expect it to work so well, but I am kind of really, really happy about it. So there's a couple of things, and every time that I talk about pairings that I try, I don't necessarily know since the beginning what's going to happen. What I do know is that I'm open to all possibilities, and so sometimes I even try some really oddly odd matches, in the sense that the tarot deck could be completely different. It's just I really think that I should try them out, and the reason why I'm saying this now is because the next deck I'm going to pair the Wild Child Oracle with is probably not a tarot deck you would think immediately when thinking about this oracle deck. Let me show you what I mean. Okay, so ready? Ta-da! This is the Fifth Spirit Tarot by Charlie Claire Burgess. I actually don't even know whether it's to be pronounced the French way or the English way. This is the name of the author. I love this deck so much. It's probably my favorite peepish deck. The peeps in this deck are simply beautiful, and there's no two ways around that. I know that it's a bit of a risky move. I know that you know, many of you would go, it really doesn't have anything to do, you know, these two don't share anything, they don't share the same color palette, they don't share the same art style. So in the meantime, I'm just trying to shuffle this, because I think the last time I probably put it back in order. Anyway, we'll see. So sometimes you just have to go with your gut feeling, right? You have to try something, and perhaps it doesn't work, but at least you know that it doesn't work. Because if you don't try it, you'll never know. So the reason why I wanted to try these two out together was indeed because the minors in the Fifth Spirit Arrow are kind of peepish, but they're beautiful peep. Let's say there is an effort behind the choice of the peeps. So let's have a look. Even the borders are different. As I said, the art style is different. And yet, I don't know, but I think it kind of works. I think that there is something here. There's something here. The rainbow between the King of Cups and the Five of Wands. See what I mean with the peeps, but not lazy peeps. There's actually an effort in choosing what the images will look like. So, mirage between the Eight of Pentacles and the Knight of Wands. I'm trying to think of what the associations can be. Opportunity between the Devil and the Eight of Wands. And labyrinth between the Page of Pentacles and the Page of Swords. Idleness. I don't know what you think. I think I like it. I mean, idleness between the Tower and the Two of Swords. It tells us that there is a moment in which it's okay to stay idle. Like this figure looking at the tower, the house, you know, being struck down by lightning and burning down, and just being there, standing still and looking at it. There is a time in which idleness is actually okay. So the idleness, it's also the concept we were reading about earlier in the Goddess of Love Tarot. We were talking about the Two of Swords, and the concept of idleness came about. It's the time in which it's okay to stay still. I feel that there's desolate between the Queen of Swords and the Four of Cups. Definitely feel the vibe here. I also like the way in which there is this kind of, it's a reminder of, you know, the meaning of the Four of Cups, desolation or something desolate. Because if you don't nourish what you've got in the suit of water, if you don't water your plants, that's the result you're gonna get. And it's also a caveat, it's also a warning for the Queen of Swords. You cannot be too dry, because this is what is going to happen if you don't water your plants, basically. And the Six of Cups and the Fog and the Queen of Wands. Again, we've got that sense of that image, you know, in the fog, right in the distance between the reality and what we think. It's the memory of a time in which things were simple and easy to live with. With the Queen of Wands, I really like this combination. I'm saying I know perfectly well that we are nowhere near the same art style, and aesthetically we're not even the same planet, but sometimes it doesn't have to be that way. Sometimes matches actually work also because they are complementing each other, not necessarily because they exist in the same level, in the same realm. So I'm actually quite happy that I have tried these two together, because I think it actually works. I don't know, let me know in the comments below, what do you think about these two decks together? Is it something that, is it something that it's not feeling like it works or not? I think it does, and sometimes we also do have these kind of commonalities and similarities in the symbols, and you know, the busy card, you know, the root between the World and the Nine of Pentacles is absolutely right. I mean, the Nine of Pentacles is not just the windfall, is going towards the completion in the suit of the earth, and so grounding ourselves and finding a reason to you know, grow out of those roots, which is basically the accomplishment in the World card. These two are definitely growing on me. I don't know whether I'm just convincing myself about that. Maybe I want it to work, and therefore I'm trying to find a reason to make it work, but I think it actually does. I think it actually does. So I'm quite happy to see these two together. So there is another deck that I want to try out with this oracle, and let's have a look at it quickly. And it is the Blue Earth Tarot. So the Blue Earth Tarot is by Alison Davies, and it's an indie deck. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to put these ones at the bottom so we still have enough cards to level the decks. And I'm just going to go quickly, because otherwise this is going to be a very long video. So I'm not sure about this one. See, in this case, this one would have been a deck that I would have picked even before the Fifth Spirit Tarot to pair up with the Wild Child Oracle. And yet, now that I'm using them together, I don't necessarily see or I don't necessarily feel that these two actually work together, probably because the tarot deck is a bit too minimalist. And don't get me wrong, I absolutely love this tarot deck. It's so beautiful. It's very moving, very moving, very touching. There is obviously the common color palette when we see the sea, because the blue earth is obviously with a predominance of blues, of shades of blue. The cocoon stage, I can probably see something here. I could probably see it working, but I still feel that this is more of a stretch. Let me put it this way. This is more of a stretch as a pair than the Wild Child Oracle with the Fifth Spirit Tarot. Again, just let me know in the comments below. I'll be very interested to know your opinion. But let's have a look at a pairing up for the Cozy Witch Tarot deck. Okay, so the first oracle deck that I'm going to try with the Cozy Witch Tarot deck is the Wooden Wardens by Jessica Wu. And it's one of those decks that I think it probably will pair up okay because of very similar earthy kind of color tones, and also the fact that, we have similar borders. Now, this one has slightly wider borders, and I keep on telling myself that I should trim them down, not necessarily just to the artwork, because I've seen a lot of people have done that, and this deck loses a bit of that kind of, let's say, authority that it feels like it's emanating, that it's projecting. But just a little bit, you know, trimming back the borders just a little bit, just not to, you know, have the impression that you're looking at something that has, you know, a frame that is actually more important than the actual artwork. I feel that these two pair up really well together. The art style is not too dissimilar, and what I feel by, you know, flipping the cards right now, it feels like they actually coexist in the same realm. There is this sense of magic, but it's magic in the everyday life. And these could be almost witches' familiars when it comes to the animals in the Woodland Wardens, because that's also something that is, it resonates a lot with that deck. I love that there is also references to plants and not just animals in the oracle, because there's plenty of references to flowers and elements of nature in the tarot deck as well. And we don't actually struggle to see that. I feel that it's a very good combination, and I feel that it will actually work really, really well together. I'm kind of pleased with these two, really pleased. Now let's have a look at another couple of decks that I wanted to try out, simply because I don't know, I had a gut feeling. So let's have a look. It's the Magical Spirit Oracle by Alexis Racon. This is by Rockpool, and it's one of those decks that is rather difficult to pair up because of several different things, namely the big borders as well and the color of the borders. I always, again, like the Wooden Wardens, I talked to myself and I said, you really need to trim the borders down, maybe just a little bit, because I really don't want the frame, again, to be more important in the economy of the card rather than the actual artwork. However, I do believe that it still works if we don't focus too much on the chunky borders. I think that this is actually revealing itself to be a match made in heaven. What do you think? That really works well. That works really well. There's so, the vibes are so similar. There's a lot of similarities, but there's an actual conversation going on here. You really can tell that these two decks behave like old friends, you know, coming together after a long time that I hadn't seen each other. I'm really, really liking this. That is a fantastic match. I'm so very happy when these things happen, because they don't happen that very often, but when they do happen, it's something that obviously stays with you. And I'm really pleased. It's a beautiful match. Very beautiful match. When, you know, there's the same kind of tilt to the head in the character, and both the Oracle and the Tarot. I don't know, obviously we need to work out how to use them, because this Oracle deck, the Magical Spirit, is very unique in the sense that you have the artwork and then you have a kind of a message inside the artwork, and then you have a keyword, or a title rather, and then you have keywords. So I sometimes find myself not reading the message inside the card, but looking immediately at the title of the card and then reading the keywords and focusing on that. I'm just going to give you an idea. For example, we've got the Servant Queen with Divine, Magnetic, and Valuable between the Nine of Wands and the Seven of Wands, and it feels like it's, you know, it's telling you to stick to your own guns, just not be driven to despair by the circumstances, that indeed it takes a lot more than that to defeat you, because there is the situation in the Seven of Wands in which everyone is pointing their fingers at you, but you are divine, you are magnetic, you are valuable, extremely valuable. So don't mind that it takes a lot more than that to take you down, because you know your value, or at least, you know, the cards are telling you to acknowledge your value, recognize who you are, what you've done so far, how far you've come, and who cares if your values don't correspond to the values of your neighbors or your brother and sister-in-law, or, you know, your friends. It's what you are that is important, and what you feel you are supposed to do as your role in this world that is supposed to matter a lot more than anything else. Okay, I went off on a tangent there again. I feel like, you know, because it's rather late in the evening and it's a really nice atmosphere, I had to put on the lights as well, because otherwise I cannot really see the cards. And it's almost dusk, and I feel that these two decks are perfect for this time of the day. I don't know, is it just me? These two really work together. Look at that. It's amazing. So we got the mirror with self-reflection, right hand, and big picture. With the Four of Cups, try not to be so picky, okay? That's perfect. We have absolutely a reflection of what this card means. So just look at the big picture. Don't be so picky. You know, the Five of Wands is a good cover. Let every witch have a say. Perhaps there is a bit of a fire going on. There is a bit of a competition going on. But don't get stuck into these kind of things. You know, just look at the bigger picture. I love these two together. It makes me really, really happy, especially because this Oracle deck, as I said before, was a little bit of a difficult one to pair up. So I call it. I'm calling it. Absolutely fantastic pair. Really a match made in heaven. So this is the Cozy Witch Tarot with the Magical Spirit Oracle. Now, ordinarily, I would have shown you also a couple of, let's say, decks that I was going to pick up for the Goddess of Love Tarot. But I feel like, because I don't really understand that deck, I need to kind of dive into that deck a little bit more in order to be able to understand what the vibe of that deck is, and, you know, in order to be able to really find a good match for it. And so I'm not ready to show you my pairings for that, but I'm also curious to know what you recommend, because it's not a new deck. It's a newish deck, but it's not the newest deck, so I'm pretty sure many of you will have it. So if you have any recommendation on what, how to use that deck, you know, what to use it for, is it part of your routine, do you read it in a certain way, is it a bit of a mix between Thoth and RWS, or is it something that is completely different, and how do you like it, and what do you pair it with? And there's a number of things that, you know, I'm really looking forward to hear what you think about that deck. So just to remind you, it's just this one here, the Goddess of Love Tarot. So my plan originally was to find some pairings for this one too, but I don't feel like I'm ready to do that yet, because I just don't have a feel for the deck yet. So that was it for today. Long video, sorry about that, but thanks if you stay with me till the end of this. Very much appreciated, and more to come. Have a great day.